when the Supreme Court came down with its decision recently, saying, you know, you've got to reduce population for all these reasons, what was your reaction? Was it something good that they were doing, or something making life miserable for you, or what?
Well, it's a mixed reaction. I fundamentally agree that our prisons are overcrowded, and it makes life very difficult to run an effective, efficient prison system when you have 180% of what you're designed to have. I disagreed that, you know, with some of the particulars regarding the status of our medical and mental health care. I think we're providing pretty good care now. But at the bottom line is we had to agree that we are overcrowded and have been for some time.
So does this decision force you to either look at or actually implement some things that you were interested in all along?
Well, it does. You know, we've got, we're spending almost $10 billion on prisons in California and far less than that on higher education. It used to be the other way around. And what's really changed is that we incarcerate too many short-term offenders and low-level offenders in California. One example would be last year, we incarcerated 47,000 Californians for 90 days or less. Incredibly inefficient, ineffective system.
Why does it take the Supreme Court to tell you to reduce your population to fix something like that?
Well, in this case, Governor Brown had proposed in January in his budget a concept of realignment before the Supreme Court ever came down with this decision. Realigning, if you will, our lower level offenders to the counties, the jails and probation chiefs, and realigning the money as well so that those short-term lower level folks would stay local, which is the way it used to be.
Well, is that a good thing? I mean, was the Supreme Court urging you on to something you wanted to do anyway?
That's probably a good way to say it. We fought the Supreme Court case. We think that, you know, the state should be sovereign and we should be handling our own business. But it did provide some urgency to get this done.
And how important is the state of political gridlock in California in trying to do what you want to do in the prisons?
Well, it's very difficult. And you should be careful with new prison initiatives because you're talking about public safety and that's the governor's number one priority. That being said, we know from the Supreme Court that we're out of room, and we know from the budget we're out of money. And so we definitely had to do something about both of those issues.
You've already reduced prison population a little bit. How have you done that?
Well, we're down about 12,000 from about 172 to 160 or so. And really that's been through a couple of things. Number one is we've started to give inmates credit for accomplishments. So if you earn a GED or you learn a trade, we reduce your prison sentence just a little bit. We've stopped supervising the very lowest offenders on parole, so we stopped the technical violations, and that's helped a little. And we've also told the counties that we provided them a little funding and said, if you can do a better job of keeping probationers local, then we'll split the prison savings with you. And that's also reduced the population. So it's been a number of small steps have reduced the population, but not nearly enough to address what the Supreme Court has asked us to do.
In addition, you've sent some prisoners out of state, haven't you?
Well, that's true too. We have 10,000 or so inmates in Arizona and Mississippi and Oklahoma throughout the United States.
Does that help solve the problem, or is that just pushing it aside for a while?
You know, I think it's ultimately it's the state's responsibility to handle issues surrounding incarceration. But the out-of-state program using private providers does provide a relief valve for pretty serious inmates who would otherwise be taking up a cell and exacerbating our crowding problem. So I like to think of it as an interim solution that hopefully one day we can take care of on our own.
If the counties are going to take inmates who normally would have come to the state prisons, some people have expressed concern over that it's dangerous. What do you think?
Well, I think that you have to make sure that you've got the right inmates. And so these are folks who have never been convicted of a serious or violent offense. So they're not what we call three strikers in California. And we're also making sure that on the whole, there are the shorter term offenders. But the whole point of realignment is that counties elect sheriffs to make decisions about public safety, and they hire probation chiefs to supervise their own offenders. And the state has kind of taken on more and more of this responsibility, and we think, and they think, they can do a pretty good job.
But they're worried about, number one, overcrowding, and number two, paying for prisoners who you normally would have taken.
Right.
Can you alleviate their fears?
Well, I think there's about $1.5 billion coming their way. So we're not going to short them on the money, and that helps a great deal. But secondly, they should be concerned about, you know, their own overcrowding issues. Part of that is funding. They've got 10,000 beds, they meaning the sheriff, statewide, that they can't operate because they're underfunded and they can't hire the folks to guard these inmates. But we're going to do some jail construction as well. The state's agreed to fund 90% of jail construction in California, and so that's going to help the sheriffs in the long term.
Some people that I've talked to have said, you know, this may be an opening to bring about sentencing reform, which may be along the lines of a more permanent kind of a solution. What do you think about that?
Well, you know, I started my career in public service as a prosecutor. I was a local county DA, deputy DA, and a deputy attorney general. And I can tell you, California's sentencing scheme is as complicated as they come. And so almost everyone agrees that we could certainly improve it, streamline it, make sure that the short-term offenders are staying local and the bad guys are getting more time. That makes sense. It's hard to get consensus around how to do that or what the outcome should be.
Yeah, the ideological logjam in California politics seems so strong at this point. So much they hardly talk to each other in Assembly and the Senate these days. You wonder if anybody is going to get to a real solution to this problem other than short-term solutions. What do you think?
Well, you know, I think this whole concept of realigning short-term offenders and some funding locally is a big step in the right direction. It's a lot to swallow all at once, and so we'll need to work on this piece for a little while. And then maybe it's time to take a look at the long-term issues surrounding, do we build more prisons for long-term offenders? What do we do with those who are here illegally? We have 19,000 who are undocumented in our prisons. And what do we do about the issue of sentencing? And so we'll have to take those on in turn.
Some people in the legislature have been concerned that there may be dangerous people out on the street because of all of this pressure. Do they have reason to be concerned?
Well, there's a lot of confusion about realignment and the U.S. Supreme Court's order, and you hear the term inmate release all the time. From our perspective, we're not going to release. Anybody who's in prison today is going to serve their full sentence. All of these changes will be prospective. So it's diverting tomorrow's inmate to jail instead of prison, for example, to serve their time. And that alleviates people's fears. But ultimately, if the state doesn't act in some way, then the U.S. Supreme Court has said that we may see an inmate release, and I think that's something to be avoided. And so we're trying to take steps proactively to avoid just that.
Is that a serious threat, do you think?
Oh, I think it is. They've said they'll give us time, and they want a plan that's consistent with public safety. But if the legislature and the governor hadn't acted on these short-term offenders, and if we don't see some construction and long-term solutions, then we're really just daring the court to act. And I don't want to be in that situation, and I don't think anybody in California should want that.